Madhav Gadgil is a name that comes to our mind as soon as we hear about the Western Ghats, which has been included in the list of the World Heritage Sites. He is one among those personalities who had authoritatively and categorically called for the protection of Western Ghats. When he marked the whole of the Western Ghats as ecologically sensitive zone, political parties and religious organizations raised the protest, pointing out that it would lead to the eviction of farmers. However, all of them have now begun to reconsider the issue. Now Kerala is going back to Madhav Gadgil for direction in different ways. Today, I have great pleasure to welcome Sri Madhav Gadgil, who has consented to talk to us about the importance of the protection of the environment and biodiversity at the multidisciplinary seminar series Agora 2021, conducted by Srinarayana College, Kollam. I also welcome seminar convener Dr. Jisha, IQAC coordinator Dr. S.V. Manoj, teachers, students, members of the public, and all who are attending the seminar. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you, Sunil Kumar, sir. With great respect and love, inviting today's speaker, the well-known ecologist, academician, and writer, Madhav Gadgil ji, to the talk number 33 of our third edition of Agora webinar series, organized by Sri Narayana College, Kollam. Over to you, Gadgil ji.
Suhurtakale, yallavarikum, namaskaram.
Thank you.
It is a great pleasure for me to be here with you and to address this multidisciplinary gathering, as you say. What I want to talk about is a rational approach to conserving biodiversity. Conserving biodiversity is very much an issue that appeals to me greatly. I am committed to that, but I believe that what we need is, next slide please. What we need is a rational approach. Today, we are talking about this. The framework in which biodiversity is being managed is highly irrational. And this is a pity, because after all, I believe the world's foremost and oldest, perhaps, rationalist, Gautam Buddha, was born in India. And as you will see, he was emphatic that you should not believe anything, no matter where you read it or who has said it, not even if Buddha himself has said it, unless it agrees with your own reason and your own common sense. And I think this is what we need to inject into our approach now. Environmental science, yours is also multidisciplinary, as you mentioned. Environmental science is something special. All other sciences, be it physics or chemistry, it is possible for a scientist to focus on something very narrow, one very specific issue, and do some very important, make a very important contribution. But environment is an area where, unless you have a systems view, it is not possible to really clarify what is going on and to come up with any worthwhile suggestions, worthwhile findings, worthwhile recommendations. And when you say a systems view, the systems view is not just biological or physical factors or chemical factors, but very much social, economic, political factors, cultural and religious factors. All of them play a role, and we must appreciate and deal with it. And ecology is also a historical science. What has been happening over the course of time is very important in influencing what is happening today. So in this talk, what I hope to be able to do is to put before you such a systems perspective and suggest ways for us to go ahead. Next, please. One of the important aspects we must consider in this systems perspective is the fact that India has a very rich tradition of respect for and conservation of nature. One of the elements is the sacred grounds. And as you might recall, Buddha himself was born in a sacred grove, the sacred grove of goddess Lumbini. Next. Our tiny neighbor Bhutan is a Buddhist country, and importantly, apart from the religion, it has retained this tradition of protection of nature. One of the famous hills in Bhutan, which I had the privilege of visiting some years ago, is the hill on which this Tiger's Crag Monastery is perched. And this hill is a large hill which is entirely covered by a sacred grove. At one time, I believe Kerala's Sabarimala was also such a sacred mountain. In the sense, it still is. But now the great sacred grove on the Sabarimala hill has been disturbed. Not so with this Tiger Crag Monastery's hill. The whole sacred grove is still intact. Next, please. This is a tradition still alive in India, on our Western Ghats especially, though in many other parts of India, once the whole of the country was covered by a network of sacred groves. I now stay in Pune, and this is a sacred grove in one of the villages, actually 30 kilometers from where I'm standing and talking today to you. I spent some time with the villagers and discussing, understanding the matter, staying with them. And it was very clear that it was not just a religious belief that was prompting the villagers to save the sacred grove. They were perfectly aware that these sacred groves, including this one, was safeguarding the local stream. It was providing leaf litter, which they would pick, and medicinal plants, which they may collect without disturbing it. But it was also, importantly for them, refugia for hunted animals. All of Indians have been hunting forever, really, almost all. I cannot say all. There are in India a small minority, actually, of vegetarians. But the other Indians have been hunting over thousands and thousands of years. And what is the deforestation? You see the rest of the landscape completely devastated. When I stayed and talked to people, I came to understand that it was the irrigation engineers who were, by the way, this is in the catchment of a major dam which supplies water to Pune, Panchen Dam. When the roads reach this otherwise earlier remote area for the construction of the dams, the irrigation engineers arranged with the local timber merchants, and especially the charcoal merchants, to come to this place, and forest department people very much so also joined hands, and they wiped out, you will see, the whole forest. So the notion that it is the rural people who have destroyed the forest and who are destroying the forest, I discovered, this was 50 years ago fully actually, I discovered was completely wrong-headed, that it was the corrupt bureaucrats, the irrigation engineers, and even more so the foresters, who were responsible for the devastation and desertification of this landscape, which was once covered entirely with evergreen forests. Next, please. So that is why I say I want to look at the issue of conserving biodiversity rationally, taking cognizance of our rich traditions and people's wisdom, and issuing both the rhetoric of those who say wildlife first at all costs and those who say GDP growth at all costs. Again, let me go to Bhutan, as I said, where I had the privilege of spending a few days, and the Bhutan king completely voluntarily, there was no demand for, he was very popular, no demand for him to step down, but he had voluntarily called for elections, and a parliament, new parliament had been constituted, and those parliamentarians had invited me. I talked to them at length apart from seeing their country. They said Bhutan pursues not gross national product like India does. I'm afraid as part of India, Kerala does. It pursues gross national happiness. And where does our happiness lie in? The Bhutanese said that our happiness lies in protecting the environment, having an honest, non-corrupt, clean administration, in promoting social harmony, and their values of Buddhist religion. Let's set aside the religion for the moment, but certainly the other three pillars of state policy, I believe, are pillars which are very important for us as well. Next slide, please. Again, as I am insisting, I want to put before you that one must examine everything skeptically, and you must anchor yourself to objective facts, however unpalatable they may be. Our Western Ghats Ecology Expert Panel report was extremely unpopular amongst politicians and other Western interests because it put forward quite straightforwardly objective facts with abundant evidence to back them, but they were often unpalatable. Next, please. Next slide, please. Well, let's begin, in a sense, at the beginning when the international agenda began to incorporate environmental issues. So this was the 1972 Stockholm Conference, the UN Conference on Environment, which brought environment to the forefront of all countries. Our Prime Minister, Mrs. Indira Gandhi, was there, and she was a very good speaker, an impassioned speech, saying that poverty is the greatest polluter. Fine. So next slide, please. Next slide, please. What actions, concrete actions, happened in India in 72, one may inquire. On part of the government, they brought in the Wildlife Protection Act. And I will have much more to say about this act, which somehow has been made the pillar of biodiversity conservation in India. And I think very wrongheadedly, a pillar of biodiversity conservation in India. We also, in the same year, launched the Project Tiger. And this project was launched at the urging of the World Wildlife Fund, of which the husband of Queen Elizabeth, Prince Philip, was one of the important moving forces and one of the founders. I will talk more about these British practices and what they told us. But on part of people, there was very importantly the Chipko Andolan. We all perhaps are aware of the fact that in Uttarakhand, in Garhwal Himalayas, there was this Chipko Andolan, which, next slide please. What were their demands? Chipko was initiated because the Alakananda valleys where it was, it began. Alakananda is one of the major tributaries of Ganga. The forest department was organizing cutting of the forests of their native oak and rhododendron to supply wood to cricket bat industry at highly subsidized rates. I will give you some more examples later. You have your own example in Kerala of Maungur Rayon and the kind of incredible subsidies which were offered to Maungur Rayon for the bamboo. Anyway, so this was the same kind of thing. And the resulting deforestation was adversely impacting their livelihoods. It was causing landslides and floods in Alakananda. And this has, unfortunately, as we have seen in this February, continued. Anyway, the strength of the Chipko activists at that time came from the Vana Panchayat forests. In 1930s, Govind Vallabh Pant, who was one of the freedom fighters, Gandhian freedom fighter, he had agitated and ensured that the Uttarakhand villages were granted management rights over Vana Panchayats. Traditionally, the panchayats, the Gram Samajas, had been managing forests, but this was formalized as Vana Panchayat forest. There have been very careful studies of this, these Vana Panchayats, and they have shown that they were maintaining better tree cover than in the reserve forest, and at 1/10 the cost of forest department's management of reserve forests. In some of those studies, I have myself participated. And we also looked at, and my group in the Indian Institute of Science looked at the success of the plantations of the Chipko activists, which were taken up after 1972, and of the forest department. The survival in the Chipko activists forests, eco-development camp-based forests, was 80%. That in the forest department's plantations was only 20%. Next slide, please. So, what is this forest department? Today, a air has been created by at least the urban nature lovers who are, unfortunately, I will come to show, unthinkingly backing the forest department as if forest department is the sole protector of environment in India. But how did this forest department arose? The Britain, of course, when they conquered, they said they were here to civilize our barbaric country. That time, India was one of the wealthiest countries in the world. All they wanted, of course, was to drain the resources. So India's village communities had been taking very good care of their community lands. So all the early British accounts say India is an ocean of trees. So England wanted to confiscate these village woodlots without any compensation, and Forest Department was set up as an agency in the name of conservation to confiscate. Among other things, they banned shifting cultivation. And the shifting cultivation, there were some revenue officials in Madras Presidency of that time who said that shifting cultivation is a very good way of livelihood for people, and it is sustainable at that time, and that it should not be banned. The tea and coffee planters of South India insisted that the shifting cultivation must be back so that they will have labor on their plantations. And in the Pettugudi and the other landslides in recent years, where these tea labor plantations huts have been crushed, Kerala has been witnessing the way these labor were treated once they came in the grip of the state owners. Next, please. So this forest department, although talked of conservation, it liquidated forests, giving large tracts to tea and coffee planters, to British cantonments, huge, highly subsidized supplies for railways for laying down their railway lines for sleepers and burning as fuel in railway engines, built wooden ships for British Navy. And at the same time, it harassed common people and extorted bribes. So there was this dual policy of harassing common people and extorting bribes and giving highly subsidized wood for the rich and the poor. Next, please. Mahatma Gandhi, on the other hand, had other ideas. He was thinking of India as becoming a republic of self-reliant villages, and he advocated that we want this, what we need is Sarvodaya, development for all. And he said, beginning, you must begin with putting the last first, Antyodaya, putting the weakest and the poorest first. And we have our All India Radio has this motto, Bahujana Hitaya, Bahujana Sukhaya. Well, actually, it is part of one of Buddha's sermons. So Buddha's vision was also very similar to Mahatma Gandhi's vision. And at Mahatma Gandhi's insistence, Congress actually endorsed that villages will be handed back their village woodlots on independence. Next, please. But what did our first Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru ji did? He completely set aside all Gandhian ideas while paying lip service to Gandhi and worshipping him on the 2nd October. He completely rejected all Gandhian philosophy. He was, after all, educated in Harrow and Cambridge, a British product of British education, and all he was talking about was catching up with the West. He launched on the India on path of what he called development at all costs, which in practice meant development at the cost of the weak and the poor. Putting the last down, actually. This is one of the typical reservoirs, one of the largest reservoirs on the Western Ghats, Koyna Nagar in Maharashtra. I spent some time there also. Anyway, so this was the temple, supposedly, of modern India. That temple, it destroyed huge area of wilderness, forests, and large number of people were displaced. None of them were properly compensated. They were impoverished. Next slide, please. So, in Jawaharlal Nehruji's regime, a forest policy came up for review in 1952. If Gandhian vision had been followed, it would have been very different. But Nehruji completely reaffirmed the hegemony of the forest department in this new policy. So one of the outcomes was the West Coast paper mills established in 1958, maybe very similar to Mahul Rayon, I guess it might have been established around the same time. And the basket weavers of Karnataka, they ground the finance minister of Karnataka, Murar Rao Ghorpade, who was a very decent person, and he was a personal friend of mine because he was very fond of wildlife photography and I was involved in wildlife research. So he asked me to review this independently. He said if I ask Forest Department or Paper Mill to say whether the basket weavers are justified, they will say that, of course not. I want you to do an independent study. And I did. And what did I find? Bamboo was being supplied to the mill at 1.5 rupees per ton. And the basket weavers had to buy it at 100 times as much, at 1500 rupees per ton. And the mill had illegally enclosed large forest areas. I saw personally, they were beating up displaced villagers when they entered what was their own forest. And the mill's unsystematic and improper harvest of bamboo in collusion with forest department exhausted it. They polluted the air and water. And they did not pay any price. So in modern day, this has come to be called crony capitalism. And what is crony capitalism, which I guess rules the roost in India today, is to squeeze the poor to feed the rich. Next, please. So what did the Wildlife Protection Act 1972, which was brought in the same year that Mrs. Gandhi said poverty is the greatest polluter. So in India, did this act actually do something to reduce poverty, or did it worsen poverty? All evidence is that it has greatly worsened poverty. Forest Department till this act had its hold only over the forested areas. Now the hold was extended to the entire country. Wherever you are in the country, you are under the tyranny of the Forest Department. And one of the targets which they immediately had was the Chipto activists and their Van Panchayats. And they made sure that the Van Panchayats, which had been functioning properly, were dismantled. They were not allowed to function. And the local people were therefore weakened and could not anymore resist the onslaught of this destructive development. So who was behind this? These are the people who are today leading the voice of urban nature conservationists in endorsing the tyranny of the Forest Department and continually claiming that it is the villagers, the Adivasis, who are destroying the forest. They took the lead in framing India and this Wildlife Protection Act. It was certainly an important natural history organization since 1883. Throughout, from beginning, it was dominated by British merchants, British civil servants, British police officers, and the tea and coffee planters. It so happened that my father was very fond of bird watching. He was a friend of Salimani, and he was a member much before my birth. And on my 21st birthday, he gifted me a life membership of this society. So I have known them intimately from very early. And I am afraid, although of course Salimani was a great man and my inspiration for life, but he had many flaws. Next, please. Next slide, please. So, apart from the Britishers and the members of the society, including better off Indians, often educated in Britain. And Salim Ali's family was one of these. He was greatly influenced by these Britishers and Americans from an early age. He was very fond of shikar. At the age of 10 or perhaps before that, he was shooting with his air gun, sparrows. And one of the sparrows he shot had yellow throat and he took it to BNHS. And so he began his association with the society. Now, as I said, he was my inspiration, and I was from the age of 14 onwards, till he passed away at the age of 91. I was a friend of his. I spent a lot of time with him in the field trips. We wrote some scientific papers together, but it was clear that he was alienated from the common people of India. I and my father were not. Next, please. So, amongst the most influential members of this Bombay Natural History Society were the tea and coffee planters. Many of them were enthusiastic hunters. Some of them were very good naturalists. And they wrote brilliant accounts of Indian natural history in the BNHS journal, which I read avidly as a schoolboy. But they uniformly regarded common people of India with contempt and treated them like slaves on their plantation. This is a the club in Munnar with the, and you can see all the animal heads on the wall. They shot animals at will, and one of them actually, I got to know, he was not a Britisher, I must say. He was a successor, Indian successor of these Britishers. He told me that, look, it is gentlemen who hunt for pleasure. It is the poachers who hunt for the pot. And the poachers must be put down. No poaching should be allowed. It is the hunting by the gentlemen, like all these British tea planters, that is legitimate. Any hunting by the common people is illegitimate. Next, please. So, when British were ruling the country, they went on a great hunting spree. They, of course, conquered in India. That was an ocean of trees which was great. And they went on an incredible massacre of India's wildlife. Just one example. This is a plaque from Bharatpur. The British Viceroy of Linlithgow at that time, on a single day, shot as many as some 4,273 water birds on this wetland. Next, please. Next slide, please. So, Salim Ali was a hunter, a passionate hunter. And when, in 1972, when he was fully 76 and Wildlife Protection Act stopped hunting, till that age he was hunting. But Nehru and Gandhi were interested in birds. Like, as I said, my father was, I was, and Salim Ali wielded great influence with those who were bird watchers of India, naturally because of his accomplishment. But he worked closely with Dylan Ripley, the head of Smithsonian Institution, and now the papers declassified from American records have proved that Dylan Ripley was an American CIA agent. He was in charge of Southeast Asia and Asia throughout the Second World War. He continued to be associated with American spying effort. He continued to be associated with American efforts to develop biological warfare weapons. These biological warfare weapons were later deployed by the United States to, with great tragedy in a way, in the war against Vietnam, which they finally lost. And Salim Ali used to, as I said, we spent a lot of time together in the field. And he used to tell me that he and Dylan Ripley had hunted tigers in the Khasi Hills. And maybe there are many man-eating tigers, but few tiger-eating men. Dylan Ripley and Salim Ali had enjoyed tiger meat kebabs on the Khasi Hills after they hunted them. Anyway, Salim Ali flat refused. I told him that probably those rumors, there were rumors floating around of Dylan Ripley being an American spy. He flat refused to believe that. Hey, it cannot be. And as I said, now there is abundant, fully documented evidence from America's own declassified papers that he was very much an American spy. And Salim Ali took all the funds for his bird ringing research from Smithsonian. I wonder why, because he surely, with his influence with Nehru and Gandhi, he could have got funding from India, but he preferred, for some strange reason, funding from Smithsonian. Next slide, please. So, what have the consequences of the Wildlife Protection Act been? I'm a student of biological evolution, and we know that humans originated 2 lakh years ago, our species Homo sapiens, and we originated as group hunters. So till beginnings of agriculture and animal husbandry, everyone lived 10,000, 12,000 years ago. So 1,90,000 odd years ago, the whole humanity lived by on hunted meat. And vast majority of Indians till today have been hunting for all these years, and have been hunting in two ways. The few wealthy people like Salim Ali or the tea and coffee planters or the Lord Linlithgow's, the governor generals, they hunted for pleasure to show off, and others hunted for the meat and to safeguard crops. So when the Wildlife Protection Act came, those wealthy people hunting for sheer pleasure like Salim Ali suffered nothing. They did not need the wild meat to feed them. They had their chicken and mutton and fish, and they did not suffer from destruction of crops anyway. So, all the common people of India suddenly were branded as criminals. Can you imagine, with no thought as to how this will affect them? Our supposedly Garibi Hatao regime of Mrs. Indira Gandhi never thought if this was going to affect them adversely. And since 72 till today, now almost 50 years, the numbers of wild animals have grown well beyond the carrying capacity of the national parks and wildlife sanctuaries. In all other countries in the world, India is the unique exception. Protection of wildlife is restricted to national parks and wildlife sanctuaries. Outside, there is hunting in every country in the world, as we will see later. In Britain also, who have been preaching us through World Wildlife Fund not to hunt outside the, throughout the country. So, what we have is humongous human-wildlife conflicts. Next slide, please. Anyway, one example of how people like Salim Ali, alienated from common people of India, did not even think about all this. So Salim Ali had been doing ringing in the Bharatpur sanctuary for many years, with Smithsonian funding, as I told you. But he had never thought of other than birds. He had no idea of the overall understanding of the ecosystem. And ecology is a science where you must have a systems view. You cannot just focus on one component such as birds. All he had about the rest of the system was prejudices. So he said, we must ban access of the villagers and their buffaloes to the wetland, which would improve it as a bird habitat. In fact, I don't want to spend too much time, but I went on many field trips with him in Bharatpur. Every evening, the buffaloes will be returning and we'll go for a walk, and he will tell me, Madhav, once the wretched buffaloes are gone, we will be safe. The wetland will be safe. Okay, so he wrote to Indira Gandhi, it became a national park. So the villagers naturally protested. 7 of them died in police firing. This is taken as routine in India. Nobody gives a damn if the villagers die in police firing. And I don't think Salim Ali ever had any remorse for the death of these villagers. And what happened? The wetlands did not improve, as a result of this ban. It was buffalo grazing, which was keeping a water-loving grass, paspalum, under control in the wetland. With buffaloes gone, paspalum grew unchecked. It became not a wetland anymore, but a shallow wet grassland. And it was a very much worse habitat for the birds. So I was, of course, involved with that group, and Dr. V.S. Vijayan, who was my colleague, and he on the Western Ghats Ecology Expert Panel, he was actually heading this research. And I know from him that all this unfortunate outcome happened. But I must say that the BNHS scientists were very guilty. They wrote this up in a report to the Smithsonian Institution, which is not made public. And this unfortunate consequence of the ban has never been brought to public notice properly. Dr. Vijayan and people should have published this in a paper accessible to people in a scientific journal, not in a report to Smithsonian headed by American spies. Anyway, next slide, please. Next slide. So, you have this humongous human-wildlife conflict. Of course, it has recently hit me very home because I have been involved very much with the villages which have been granted forest resource community rights in Gadchiroli district, and they are doing a very good job. And I have roamed these forests since at least 1991 off and on, and after they got the community forest rights, much more frequently since 2010. And in the forests which I have roamed, now there are man-eating tigers. And this lady who had gone to collect firewood because they have no other source of fuel, she was killed by a tiger. And it struck me home that today if I'm wandering in that forest, then I would also fall a victim to the man-eating tiger. So of course, perhaps one should not have to become aware because of such personal facts, but I must confess that I really became aware of this horrible conflict, human-wildlife conflict. This is going on in India. This is a summary which Dr. Pabla, who was a retired chief conservator of forest wildlife of Madhya Pradesh, has written. He was one of the conscientious, honest forest officers. He says, nearly 1,000 people are killed by wild animals like elephants, leopards, tigers, and sloth bears, while tens of thousands are injured each year. And in Kerala, I understand, some of my friends have told me, that in last 10 years, something like 400 people have been killed by elephants and others. Losses of crops and property at the hands of elephants, wild pigs, blue bull, black buck, gaur, etc., runs into thousands of crores rupees. And the way our weird legal framework is, people are not free to defend themselves against marauding animals, as even driving them out of their homes and crop fields requires official sanction. Next, please. Next slide. This is fine. So I started examining this. This is a wild pig in one of the, I guess, rice paddies in Kerala. Wild pigs are amongst the more serious pests. And by the way, worldwide, the data is that wild pig is becoming a greater and greater menace everywhere in the world. From Canada, there are reports that now wild pig has become a serious pest in Canada. I mean, there is no question that wild pig is a pest It is in no danger of extinction. There is no justification There is an echo by our voice, okay?
Now okay, sir.
Okay, so what we have, so I inquired, and I have a retired justice of Mumbai High Court, is a good friend of mine, and a retired Director General of Police of Maharashtra is another good friend of mine. I talked to them, and when I told them the facts, they said, look, Wildlife Protection Act is not valid constitutionally. They asked me to look at Indian Penal Code sections 100 and 103, which sanction voluntary causing of death of or other harm to any wrongdoer if the wrongdoer has mounted an assault and you have reasonable cause to apprehend that death or grievous hurt will be a sequence of such assault. And recently, I understand even wild boar have killed people in India. If the offense involves wrongdoer committing house or property trespass or robbery, the wild pigs are certainly trespassing on property, on the farmer's fields, and they are robbing him of the precious produce. So they have to, there is no question that farmers have every right to deal with this wild pig, and they even should not have to ask for official permission to kill it. And once the official permission is granted, then the forest department asks the pig to be burned. Damn it, India, if you look at the statistics in world statistic, India has a higher proportion of hungry people than any other country in the world. And if you have a country with very high proportion of hungry people, and wild pig meat is a very tasty and enjoyable food, and you don't allow people to eat it, this is absurd. It is clear these both this police boss and justice have told me that this is an unconstitutional act. You should have a PIM asking the act to be declared unconstitutional. And this retired justice of Mumbai High Court has said he will be co-signatory with me on this PIL, and he will make sure that the act is removed. Next, please. So, what are the other consequences of Wildlife Protection Act? It having extended the stranglehold on the entire community, they used it to subjugate the people of Uttarakhand, the Chipko activists. They sabotaged and destroyed the one panchayat functioning, and people could not resist the kind of destructive developments and the continual chain of such destructive developments has led to the February this year landslide and huge tragedy of Chamoli. And in Chamoli, not only did many people die, but the dams and the roads were themselves destroyed. So in the end, this investment is not even economically justifiable. Next, please. Next slide, please. And how has this whole thing come? The whole thing is that we Indians have, at the prompting of Britishers, did what they don't practice. All they wanted was use our rich wildlife to organize nature-based tourism. That has been organized in Africa. Land is taken over forcibly by displacing native people. All the operations are owned entirely by Europeans, and natives are employed only as drivers or waiters. India, similar, though not quite the same, because we are different from these African countries, is also patterned going on in our Project Tiger reserves. And the Britishers are hunting. The Britishers go to this game ranch in Burkina Faso, which is a South African country. They hunt there, these elephants you see here, they hunt them and they carry back trophies to Britain, the United States and other countries. Next, please. So, what is happening in Britain? Who is preaching us all this banning hunting throughout the country through their WWF founded by their own Prince Philip? It is full of shooting in estates. And as many as 12,300 wild mammals and birds are killed every day in Great Britain. And they go, as I said, trophy hunting to African game ranches and import lions and leopard skulls and elephant leather to show off in their drawing rooms. And this WWF has taught us to not hunt even wild pigs in our country, and we are swallowing that. Next, please. So, what the most lucrative ecotourism business run in India is run by a British family. They were prominent members of Bombay Natural History Society. And since, as I said, I was associated with that society since actually childhood, age of 14, I knew this lady also, one of the ladies involved, very well. She has, and her cousins and other family members, they have a ecotourism camp at Kanha National Park and in Sundarbans, Kanha Tiger Reserve, and Sundarbans Tiger Reserve. And they are making enormous amounts of money. It is to profit. And she was very, very forceful in advocating the passage of Wildlife Protection Act and the Project Tiger Constitution. This is all recorded in her biography also in Wikipedia. And interestingly enough, she has been awarded a member of the Order of British Empire by the Queen. So Indians are exploited through ecotourism to win awards from Queen Elizabeth by this very capable and forceful lady. I know her personally. Next, please. And what is the Forest Department's record? Sarishka, which is a tiger reserve not far from Delhi. So the Forest Department was claiming there were 20 tigers present. Prime Minister ordered CBI to look into this. CBI reported that all tigers had been poached out by 2004, and carcasses of several poached tigers had been skinned and were stinking. And there is no question that Forest Department officials were conniving in this poaching. But what did happen on the ground, Delhi, are indifferent, unfortunately. Villagers were beaten up, and not a single forest officer was called to book. And I know all this because later, apart from CBI, Prime Minister Manmohan Singh constituted a tiger task force of which I was a member, and CBI gave us these facts in camera, but they did not allow us to publicize them. So all this corruption and so on is always to be put under the rug, and the system, a most unjust system, has to be perpetuated. Next, please. As a scientist, one asks, what should be the priorities? Should tiger be the highest priority for conservation? No, you must look at how scientists would assign conservation value. I won't go into the details, but on all those counts, it is the gharial, this crocodilian from the river, dwelling crocodilian, which is far more valuable than tiger. And it is disappearing. And amongst the reasons for disappearance is the incredible pollution of the river waters in India. But this is completely ignored. Next, please. Next slide, please. So the outlook now has changed, that from protection of game, as they called it, in 1972 also, in some sense, that was the idiom in use. In 1992, with the Rio conference, they said, the conference concluded that we must not think only of these tigers and elephants and rhinoceros, but of the total biodiversity of life on Earth. And just like Salim Ali was one of my gurus, I must say, I'm proud of the fact that Edward Wilson, who was responsible for propagating the concept of biodiversity, was my PhD guide at Harvard. Anyway, so the objectives of the conservation convention on biological diversity talk about conservation, sustainable use, and equitable sharing of benefits. Biodiversity is not simply to be protected, but sustainably used. And it the convention talks about the importance of pertinent knowledge and traditions of local communities, and that they should be given an important role. Next slide, please. So the Biological Diversity Act, which was drafted by a committee headed by Dr. Swaminathan, and happened to be a member, made provisions for this, that it provides for protection of ecosystems and of total gamut of biodiversity. But local communities have an important role in the preservation of these ecosystems. Forest Department has captured the whole machinery of Biological Diversity Act implementation, and they have formulated weird rules which have removed the management role of the panchayats. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. So, what is driving the loss of biological diversity is something else. And this is not at all recognized by the official machinery. It is the water pollution. It is the slaughter of trees like banyan and peepal and others, which are important for conserving, supporting biological diversity by roads and railways. This is completely ignored, and all the focus is on, again, tigers and elephants and rhinos and throwing out people. Next slide, please. So, they are counterproductive. As you know, the fact that Forest Department is a tyrannical outfit, which people at the ground level hate, is used by the vested interests to make sure that people are against environmental protection. This is exactly what happened in Kerala. The Fragile Lands Act of Kerala, you will probably have better understanding. Whatever I have been given to understand by my friends in Kerala was that it was implemented in a way to harass people, not to really protect the forest, and again to extort bribes. So people are against environmental protection. Next slide, please. And this is exploited by certain vested interests. For example, the Bishop of Udupi very interestingly said that there will be another Jallianwala Bagh kind of situation if the Gadgil report is accepted. This, I think he could say this because people have been turned against environmental protection by this tyranny of Forest Department. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. As I said, so who is gaining from people turning against environmental protection? It is polluting industries, its mines and the rock quarries of Kerala, as you are all aware, I'm sure, who are devastating Kerala, real estate lobby, forest-based industry, which is given still resources at very low prices and huge subsidies. And of course, Netas and Babus are sharing in the ill-gotten wealth of all these polluting industries of the mines and quarry operators and so on. Next slide, please. But people, it is the people at the ground level who are protecting biodiversity through many of their traditions. This is the famous case of the actor Salman Khan, who was apprehended by the Bishnois, for whom this animal Chinkara is a kin. They say Chinkara are our brothers. And they certainly caught him red-handed, but till today, this is many years, the case is pending. He is not at all punished. Next slide, please. What do we know that need? We must turn the situation around. We must give custody of biodiversity conservation to the communities, to our Grama Samajas, to the Gram Panchayats. Kerala is a shining example of India, democratic decentralization. It is these democratic decentralized institutions which should come to play a role in proper management of biodiversity. In 1996 to 1999, Kerala had this people's planning campaign. I participated, I have lots of friends from your state, and that was a very important step forward. That is the kind of thing we need, that kind of campaign that unfortunately fizzled out later, but we need that kind of thing, and people should take charge of biodiversity conservation. They should be paid for this. Just one or two examples. Australia, there the ranch owners hunt sheep, kangaroos, because kangaroos are a menace for them. They want sheep, not kangaroos. Now Australia has a system where they have auctions. They ask them to protect 1,000 kangaroos. How much do you wish to be paid? And the ranch owners say so much. There is an open system of verification and they are paid. The lowest bidder gets the right to protect kangaroos on this ranch. So this is the kind of thing which is actually in Himachal Pradesh, I did some studies many years ago, the apple orchard owners told me that this is the kind of system which we would like to see implemented in our apple orchard country. Next slide, please. In Scandinavia, which has the highest level of living wildlife populations in any country in the world, Sweden, Norway, Finland. They have very high populations of wild animals, but everywhere they are hunted. Moose is there, like our sambar, much bigger actually. Like our sambar, this moose is an animal that can be hunted. And in fact, with friends in Sweden, I have enjoyed moose steak. It's very delicious. And reindeer, similarly, I've also enjoyed reindeer steak. All this, the Swedes, the Norwegians, the Finns, they enjoy, and yet they maintain very high levels of wildlife in their country through proper implementation of laws and through decentralization. That they also stress decentralization of management. So it is the Gram Panchayats, finally, local bodies, which should be given this role. And in India, it is possible. And this is the direction in which we must move. Next slide, please. So, as I said, it is our vibrant democracy. We have many positive laws and for democratic decentralization and elsewhere. And the Biological Diversity Act is also such a progressive law, though it is completely vitiated by the Forest Department. So this is, there are opportunities. We must seize these opportunities. Next slide, please. And we must also think of global change, the way we are acting. We had a Nisarga last year and Taukte this year. Never before have such high velocity cyclones hit the West Coast, forget 2 years in succession, even once in a while. Since the satellite imagery became available, good one in 1992, Nisarga was the first such high velocity super cyclone to hit West Coast. And now this year we have Taukte. So we must take action. And what are we doing? You know, in Madhya Pradesh, the same forest department, which is talking about people destroying forests, it has on its own proposed that 40% of the forest should be handed over, reserve forest should be handed over to industry. It is people protesting against this decision, or in Goa, against Molem Sanctuary being destroyed by the railway lines for the coal of Adani Ambani and Anil Agarwal. They are saving our biological diversity. Next slide, please. So this is what we must do. I won't go into this. One of the problems has been that we have had, after all these 75 years of freedom, very poor education and public health infrastructure. Of course, Kerala, again, I understand, is a very good counterexample. Kerala has very good education and public health infrastructure, which is a great strength. We need to bring that in. Next slide, please. And knowledge then becomes universally available. Very interestingly, very quickly, knowledge of English is becoming redundant. With the smartphones which are available and the availability made of the Indian language scripts and Indian language information by Google and by Samsung, I work with a lot of these people. We are using Marathi as a medium of communication. And you have this important social media. Next slide, please. So young people now are equipped with language information. They almost all over the country, at least some of some members from almost every family has smartphones with cameras and with Google apps like Google Copilots. By the way, interestingly enough, they no longer are handicapped by lack of knowledge of the scientific name of a species. With Google Lens and Google Photo and Google Lens, you upload an image and you immediately get the correct scientific name. So people now have incredible, young people have incredible access to knowledge. Google Translate is getting better and better. They will all now be equipped. There will be youth power, and it is this youth power which will in future transform India and take us towards a country where biodiversity is conserved in a socially desirable, environmentally positive fashion, doing away with all the corrupt bureaucracy which is currently eating up all the money in name of conserving biodiversity. Next, please. Thank you, thank you. This is one example of people having conserved our wildlife. Thank you. I am sorry, I guess I overshot somewhat, but if there is time for discussion, I will be very happy to continue to be available for as long as you like. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Sir, we have some questions in the question and answer box.
Yes, yes. As I said, if you think there is time, I am available for as long as you like.
And Dr. Bijikumar sir and Dr. Prasad sir also joined with us. Sir, please join the panel discussion. Dr. Prasad sir and Dr. Bijikumar sir.
Hello.
Yes, please.
Hello, sir. I'm Bijikumar. Excellent talk, sir. And my question to you is that, you know, even with this biodiversity act of India, and where we have the grassroots level biodiversity management committees, and why do we fail repeatedly to keep the issue of environment in the forefront? And when the main job of biodiversity management committees is now limited as only the compilation of biodiversity register, not the conservation planning which you have actually envisioned when you started the whole exercise.
No, I agree. I mean, the only recourse is for people, and especially these young people who are affected, to get together, raise their voices. After all, we have democracy. And we must force a change. I don't see any shortcut, but this is certainly possible in India. And this is the way we should proceed. It may take some time, but this is the way we should have the effort. I am aware of there is a panchayat in Kerala, maybe in Kollam district, Kottabala, where they had prepared a biodiversity register, which clearly stated that the rock quarry was destroyed, local biodiversity. The Kerala High Court at one point has upheld that if this is a properly documented finding, the rock quarry must be stopped. But vested interests managed to get it and convince the Gram Panchayat that if you say this, then all you will have is further tyranny of forest department. That's the tragedy. We must educate, the people must get educated, and they must take the lead and change the system.
Yeah, thank you, sir.
Dr. Felix? Dr. Felix, can you hear me? Sir, shall we move into the question and answer session? Gandhiji?
Sure. It is up to you. As I said, time management, you decide.
We have 28 questions in the chat box. Shall I select it or read by one?
You decide.
Okay. First question.
Is your judgment is best exercise. And if you want me to now answer any of these, I will answer them. If we don't have time for all of them, please email them and I will try to answer them later. But whatever time there is available now, I will happily answer any.
Sir, why Buddha is called a rationalist, because he is agnostic in his approach.
Why is Buddha called a rationalist? But as I said, you must read texts of Buddhism. I am very interested. So I have read. It is very clear that he said that knowledge comes from, as I said, his famous Bhumisparshaputra. He said by his enlightenment came from facts on the earth, not from any divine source. That there is no such thing as divine knowledge. All knowledge must come from objective understanding of facts on the ground. And that is exactly rationalism. And that is the basis of modern science as well.
And next from Midula, we always say, don't waste water. Sir, I want to know about the fate of water that we used for bathing or cleaning purposes that filtrate back into the soil. If that water we used is wasted, or can we get it back as pure by nature?
This is, of course, a technical question, but certainly I know that there are good systems of proper treatment and reuse of water. In fact, in one of the housing colonies here in Pune, where I'm staying, they have implemented it, and not for drinking, but for other uses, that recycled water can be used and can be also used for water in the garden. So to that level, even in India, I mean, certainly I know not far from where I'm staying now, this is being done.
Sir, one question, sir. What do you think about the statement, poverty is the greatest polluter, Indiraji's statement about?
Well, I explained at length that I am sorry, I must say very plainly, this is hypocrisy. Humans are very good at hypocrisy, as you know. This is sheer hypocrisy. Because none of our actions actually did anything to alleviate poverty, as far as I'm aware.
Sir, from Jinu again, according to your view, what are the legacies of Sundarlal Bahuguna, who passed away recently?
Sundarlal ji was involved in two important causes. One is in the Chipko Andolan. And as I said, I mentioned also at some length, Chipko was very important and strengthened with the one panchayats, well-managed one panchayats. They were protecting the environment of their region. So Sundarlal ji, along with Chandi Prasad Bhatt, they were the two stalwarts. They played an important role in this Chipko Andolan. Unfortunately, as I said, later it failed because the one panchayat management was destroyed by the forest department. He was, the other cause in which he was involved was against destructive projects. Tihri Dam was one such project where he took a very strong stand, did his best to halt it. It did not happen. And as you know now, you have had a series of such projects in that same Uttarakhand, and it has been leading, not today only, again and again, to various kinds of environmental disasters. And the recent one, February 7th, I think, of this year, was the worst of them. So, unfortunately, he failed, I'm afraid, on these both these directions. But he was, as much as he could, all through his life, insisting that we are going in the wrong directions and we must stop this. And he was a very powerful speaker. I had the privilege of knowing him personally. I had stayed in his ashram in Anakadanda Valley, Sindhara, for several days. And he had stayed with me also when visiting my house. So he was a wonderful man and a very powerful speaker, and persuasive speaker. He did his best. We must conclude, unfortunately, that he did not succeed.
Next from Anne, is the forest policy of 1952 a kind of environmental racism?
The forest policy of 1952 simply, as I said, rejected what Gandhi was saying. It continued the dominating position of forest department. Again, in an exercise of hypocrisy, he said local people are important, but they should not have any actual meaningful role in forest management. Forest management will be exclusively with the department. And I have given you history of what the department has been doing, but I have written it, Ram Guhal, I have also written it in this book, This Fish and Land, a more detailed history. It is a very negative performance of the forest department. So that forest policy confirmed the monopoly of the foresters over whatever happened in forests, and in my mind, very negative consequences.
Question from Dr. Reggie. Thank you, sir, for exposing the darker side of a stalwart. Sir, I would like to know, did any of the political decision makers of Kerala contacted you and expressed their regret after the repeated floods?
No. See, it is very interesting. Till 2011, when our Westergaard planning report was made public, I had series of assignments. I did not solicit them, but I had a series of assignments from the governments, and many government officials were in touch with me. I lived for 33 years in Karnataka, and I was actually a personal friend also of Ramakrishna Hegde, who was for a time chief minister, and Abdul Nazir Saab, one of the most honest politicians, who was rural development minister, and of many, very straightforward, honest bureaucrats, both IAS people and some of the forest service people. But after 2011, all the governmental authorities at both the central and the state government level have decided that this fellow is dangerous, he is too honest, and we shall have nothing to do with him. So nobody has ever contacted me for the last 10 years.
And from Muhammad Shamil, sir, when we are considering biodiversity and development in our country, we can see that people are divided on both extremes and not in between harmony called sustainability. Why is it so? And why the conflict of interest in environmental norms are always against common people?
There is this problem, because firstly, common people do not have access to proper information, proper understanding. Actually, I must confess that even I had not realized how much hunting the Britishers themselves did while they are advising us not to hunt. 12,300 wild birds and mammals are killed every day in Great Britain. And as I said, those same Britishers have told us through the World Wildlife Fund, which is British sponsored, to stop hunting everywhere. You know, in Hindi they say, it is tinki baji madari ki hum bandar jaise jhoomye, that the monkey controller beats his drum and you dance like monkeys. So whatever the Britishers have said, we have been dancing like monkeys, foolishly. Nobody is finding out what is actually happening in Britain or the United States or Canada. Is anywhere a law like Wildlife Protection Act existing? Nowhere in the world is such a law. It is our unique law, and to my mind, it is our unique, very pernicious law.
And from Prasad Rao, I'm curious to know from speaker whether it is the only country, whether it is only our country which suffered this or such comparable exploitation of nature happened in the past century in developed countries also.
Please repeat it.
I am curious to know from speaker whether it is only our country which suffered this such comparable exploitation of nature happened in the past century among other developed countries. What's the status of India?
See, it is possible. Now, there is global statistics available which you can actually study. Now, there are countries where there is devastating development, devastation in the name of development in a relatively small number of countries. From the statistics available, out of some 160 countries in the world for which statistics is available, about 20 countries may have worse performance than India. And where are these countries located? They are mostly either amongst our neighbors, only Afghanistan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, China, none of them have that kind of problem, serious problem. But Afghanistan amongst our neighbors, and some countries in the Africa, which are kind of victims of the Middle East conflict. You are seeing today also, there are all these news headlines of how Israel, which is the latest agent of Western imperialism in the world, and Palestinians, they are fighting. And there are a number of countries around which are affected. Those are probably worse than India. But the rest of the world is better than India.
And from Dr. Harish Kumara, as we are aware that you spent multiple decades for promoting People's Biodiversity Register, you also familiar about what is happening today's PBR at department level. What is your opinion on this People's Biodiversity Register?
No, as I said, today it is completely sabotaged, the whole purpose, the whole exercise. It has been made a meaningless exercise. So currently, all we should do is, we must actually, the people, and especially, as I said, the youth in these areas who are adversely affected, they must take the matter in hand in a democratic fashion. They must get organized. They must now protest and change the direction, the very wrong direction.
And from Sri Pavitra, sir, is there any way to bring back those tea and coffee plantation back to normal, original forest? There are similar questions from him.
If you want to stop tea and coffee planting there, we have to ponder on that. But certainly in the, I think it is Puttuvara, no? Last year's landslide was Puttuvara. In Puttuvara, good friends of mine, Dr. Subhashchandran, he's from Palakkad, he did a study in the field. And he found that where there was still natural forest around the tea plantations, it was the trees in the natural forest which did not fall down. But wherever there were other plantations, such as forest department's eucalyptus plantations, they all came down like matchsticks. So at a minimum, we must now next make sure that the remaining natural forest is not touched anymore. This is part of what our Western Ghat Ecology Expert Panel report tried to advocate. So beyond that, to replace, we must start with, I think, eucalyptus and other plantations, try to bring them back to natural forest. beard coffee plantations, you must ponder whether we can stop that economic production. But the economic production should not be done in this unjust fashion, where, you know, the laborers are forced to live in the valleys and are crushed. And you should see, I have seen photographs of the kind of huts in which the laborers in this Munnar area for the Pottuvallia landslide were forced to live. It is very clear that India is merely worsening all the time economic disparities. We must move towards more equitable society. So at a minimum, we must stop this continuing destruction of natural forests. And with these tea and coffee plantations, we must stop the kind of exploitation of labor and have a more equitable social management brought into tea plantations. That is, to my mind, the first step. Beyond that, we have to see whether we can actually bring them back to natural forest.
Sir, one special question from Jay Krishnan. Do you have any suggestion to convince people of Kerala for implementing Gadgil Committee suggestion? Because politicians and religious people try to convince people that committee report is against people.
I think only way forward is through giving proper understanding of what is in the report. Now, unfortunately, the report is very long and technical, so people don't read it. In fact, I know of a journalist who wrote a whole book of which the our report is a major theme, and he has not read it. He has simply not read the report. He gives statements which are mistaken because he has not read the report. So what has to be done is to make what is in it accessible to people. This is what I am attempting to do, that instead of this long 500-page technical report, you must have maybe 150-page readable book. And the book is called Western Ghats, a Love Story, which I'm writing. And my very good friend, Vinod Payyada, he's an activist and a lawyer from Kannur. He is good in writing in Malayalam. He is translating it simultaneously in Malayalam. So I hope that at least this material, which will give an honest view of what is in the report, accessible to people in a readable form. Once this becomes available, I have every hope that people will begin to see it changes and understand. Already, Kerala Shastra Sahitya Parishad translated the whole report in Malayalam. And there has been a positive effect of that. Many people did read that Malayalam translation. But as I said, it is too long, too technical. What you need is a more readable version, which I hope in a few months' time will become available.
And from Renuka Prasad, Bangalore University developed biodiversity park in the last 2 decades. And now it is leased out. Can we get canceled the deeds?
Sorry.
Bangalore University has developed biodiversity park in the last 2 decades.
Biodiversity park.
This is now leased out.
Leased out by whom?
I don't know. Maybe to some private parties. Can we get canceled the deeds?
As I said again,
how can they cancel it?
You must think of legal action. You must ask some competent lawyer. You might know of Harish Vasudevan. He is a very competent environmental lawyer practicing in Kerala High Court. You should ask him this question about cancellation. He would be able to give a much more useful answer and maybe take up the case. You can try and contact Harish Vasudevan.
From Dr. Shekharan, do you suggest any specific ideas to control human-animal conflict in Kerala?
Well, first and foremost, what we should do is to give up this irrational belief that you cannot kill wild animals out anywhere. I think, and as I said, in all other countries in the world, wild animals are killed outside the national park and wildlife sanctuaries. And then you can dispose of them appropriately. Elephants are being hunted by Britishers in Africa, and they are bringing back elephant leather sofas for their drawing rooms and such things. Now, in Kerala, for example, the main problems, as I understand, are elephants and wild pigs. Maybe a few others, but those are the main problems. To my mind, and I was the person who first started elephant censuses in 1975. Those are published from that time. And my PhD student, Dr. Sukumar, has continued elephant censuses ever since. And the number of elephants have increased enormously. It is not that elephants are in any way now endangered in that sense. They are in fact proliferating. And then I don't see why you should not rationally consider the possibilities which are being practiced in every other country of culling of elephants, which become too many of them and get out of wildlife sanctuaries and national parks. Okay, elephant is a different kind of animals. So in addition to wildlife sanctuaries and national parks, you might want to protect some specific wildlife corridors. Those can be declared, but if they stray outside, I don't see why we should not hunt them. And then wild pigs, it is the most absurd thing. In Kerala, many friends tell me that is the worst problem. I think all we need to do is to authorize everybody to hunt the wild pigs and to eat them, happily eat them. What is wrong? You know, there's a book on the feast that the Nepal king Ramas arranged in their palace. And one of the main items of feast for these Nepal kings was wild pig. They were eating wild pigs with relish, and there is a whole lot of recipes for wild pigs which were served to the kings of Nepal. I think we should eat them. I mean, I don't see why we should not be eating them.
And from Anita, do you support ecotourism?
Do I support?
Ecotourism.
Ecotourism is fine. Ecotourism is fine, but it should not be allowed to distort what is allowed to happen in our country. And there are good models of ecotourism, which can be ecotourism where the local communities are primarily the hosts for the ecotourism. In Goa, there is one specific village where I have stayed also, an ecotourism camp run by the local community members. It is very well run. In Bhutan, there are several ecotourism camps run by the local community members. We should try to move towards, in West Bengal also, in my place, Santhal area, I have been to such an ecotourism. So there are models available. These should not be run by these rich camp owners like Wright families camps in Sundarbans and Kada. Let the local community take charge and benefit from the ecotourism. If that is practiced and it is feasible, then ecotourism is an excellent option. I mean, why not? I should be in favor of that, but not in the present form.
And one more question, sir, from Shilpa Raj. Sir, even though frequent flood has occurred in Kerala, the houses are building in the same vulnerable areas. What is your suggestion to reduce this?
I mean, it is the real estate lobby, which is dominating the country and which is ruining our countryside. Well, I don't want to comment, but now there are some reports about in the new Kerala cabinet, who is in charge of real estate lobby or whatever business and so on. You can think for yourself. I don't want to make any political comment.
Respected organizers and honorable professor, I may ask a small question?
Sure, sure.
Sir, I am Jayachandran. I wish to ask you one question. From Biodiversity Act, one area attracting attention is ABS, access and benefit sharing. Would you please throw some light on it? Kindly elaborate on precautions. I know it is a big area.
See, access and benefit sharing, again, the way it is being practiced, it is controlled by the forest bureaucracy. They are forcing people to prepare these biodiversity registers, which are lists of plants, including medicinal plants, and even lists of the local medicine men who are using these medicinal plants. This is completely wrong. And with these lists, now all this access and benefit sharing is going on. There is a lot of money involved. I have personal experiences. A Swedish pharmaceutical company approached me some years ago. I happen to know those people well. And they said that we know that you have lists of medicinal plants of Western Ghats from all your studies, extensive lists with localities. We are interested in buying those lists. We'll pay you some huge sum, actually, I'm forgetting, maybe $10,000 per list or some such large sum they were willing to give me. And even last 2 months ago, I got a mail from a Chinese pharmaceutical company saying that, will you become our partner and give us lists of medicinal plants or whatever, similar kind of thing. I refused, of course, and I refused that Swedish pharmaceutical company also. But that's the kind of money apparently involved. And that is how all this access and benefit sharing is being run in control of the forest department's management. So that should change. But otherwise, certainly if the benefits come properly to local panchayats, in an appropriate fashion, that access and benefit sharing is just fine. But the mechanism, the system should be changed to involve the local communities properly.
Thank you.
Anyone from panelists? Manoj sir?
Yes, please.
Manoj sir, shall we move into the next session?
Yeah, okay, Rachel.
Gadgalji, we have a few more questions and I think they can email you directly.
Sure.
Shall we move into the out of thanks session? Shall we wind up the session?
Sorry, so let me understand. So now that you are suggesting we conclude the answering of questions here and you will send them by email and then I will try to answer them. Yes.
Okay.
Is that correct, my understanding?
Shall we wind up the session, sir?
I mean, if you would like, that is fine with me. It is up to you, this time management, as I said.
Okay. It's 11:45.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Shri teacher, you can propose the water thanks to.
Okay, thank you, Manoj. Good morning, all of you. Respected Principal Dr. R. Sunil Kumar sir, respected Madhav Gadgilji sir, respected IQAC coordinator Dr. S. V. Manoj, dear Agora team members, colleagues, and participants. We Team Agora 2021 is grateful to our beloved Principal Dr. R. Sunil Kumar sir for his wonderful support for organizing the webinar series. And thank you for the fabulous welcome address. Respected Madhav Gadgilji, one of the renowned ecologists our country ever seen, was our speaker today. We are so lucky to have you, sir, in the webinar series. The talk was impeccable and exemplary. No words. Your presence in our webinar series really, really added more fuels to move on, and hope it has already ignited young minds and all participants to shape their life in a more eco-friendly and sustainable manner. A bunch of thanks and love to you, Gadgilji, from Agora team members, SN College column, and on behalf of all participants joined with us today. We are indebted to Dr. S. V. Manoj, our energetic IQAC coordinator, and dear colleague, you, Adish, PTA secretary of our college. Along with their support and positive attitude, the webinar boat is sailing very smoothly. Thanks are offered to all dear colleagues, and special thanks are extended to Dr. Aparna, our staff secretary, Dr. B. Hari, Dr. Divya P.S., and Dr. Divya T. Dharan, and Dr. V. U. Shija for the beautiful support. I thank all webinar participants, especially dear colleagues, student community, teachers from colleagues and universities, Dr. Bijugumar sir, Dr. Prasad sir, J. Chandran sir, and research scholars, scientists, and general public. We value your immense support and appreciations we received till now, which is helping us to move forward in confidence. Thank you all, and have a good day.
And let me thank all of you for a patient hearing. I enjoyed the whole presentation and all the questions and answers. Thank you again.
Thank you, sir. Thank you once again. And please fill the feedback form, which will be posted in the Zoom chat box. Your e-certificates will be delivered through email. Thank you once again. Thank you.
Thank you, Jisha.
Thank you.